Hi viewers, myself Harita, a student of BAHEP from TSWRDC Ibrahimpatnam. Today I am here with the topic of Economic History of India. Before entering into my topic, I want to say a small story that in ancient period the man was just surviving without fruits. Surviving in the forest, he is just traveling from one place to another place for gathering food. He is gathering food by hunting the animals, and he used to pluck the fruits from the plants. During this period, there is no own house for his, and he used to live in the caves and in the trunks of the trees. Later, after some days, they were just exchanging food. They were exchanging meat for some fruits. That means they were by hunting they'll get meat, right? By plucking of some fruits they'll get fruits. By this they were exchanging their food. This is the basic for economics in our history. This is the basic for economics. Later on, they were formed like groups, and they were used to live in some place that is called village. In that village, they used to start farming. In the banks of the river, they used to start farming. Later on, they were exchanged their goods for food. That means, for example, take the example of the some person have meat. That person is exchanged it for something ornaments or something like chapel. They exchange. That is the second step of our economy. Later, the industrial system was introduced to our society. Then there was so many machines. There is no work for the human beings. The machines were doing the work of the human beings. Then later, IT information age came to our society. Now what we are living, that is the information technology age. Let us enter into our topic. British rule in India did not mean political control only. It extended to each and every sphere of the Indian life, like cultural, economic and social. In economic field, British rules brought about fundamental changes and transformed the Indian economy. Look at the slide, friends. Yeah, the Indian economy, the third largest economy in the world in terms of purchasing power parity, is going to touch new height in coming years. According to Global Investment Bank, by 2035, India would be the third largest economy of the world. Just after USA and China, it will grow to 60% size of the USA economy. The third largest economy in world in terms of purchasing power parity is going to touch new heights in coming years. It was declared by International Monetary Fund. It is nothing but IMF, International Monetary Fund. And let us, yeah, you may ask one thing, that what is meant by purchasing power parity? Yeah, look at this slide, friends. Purchasing power parity is an economic theory that states the exchange rate between two countries is equal to the ratio of the country's respective purchasing power. There are two ways to measure GDP of different countries and compare them. One way, GDP called at exchange rate, is when the currencies of all countries are converted into USD. That means USD stands for United States Dollar. The second way is GDP at PPP, or GDP at purchasing power parity. Here PPP stands for purchasing power parity. Yeah, economic history of India is, or India is divided into three phases, friends. Three phases. That is, look at the slide, friends. Economy of India is divided into three phases. First one is pre-colonial phase, and the second one is colonial phase, and the third one is post-colonial. Let us come back to the screen. You might have thinking that what is meant by colonial, right? Colonial is nothing but, the meaning of the colonial is belonging to a country that controls another country. Here, colonialism also given that the policy or practice acquiring full or partial political control over another country, occupying it with settlers and exploiting it economically. For your convenience, I am saying one example, that is, Britishers come to our India on the purpose of business, right? They came to our India and they started controlling us. That is called colonial. And here colonialism is nothing but the rule of the Britishers. The rule of the Britishers is called colonialism. Yeah, let us enter into next slide. Yeah, pre-colonial phase. The economic history of India since Indus Valley Civilization to 1700 AD is called pre-colonial phase. You can see the picture of Indus Valley Civilization here. You can see the picture of Indus Valley Civilization here. During this phase, our Indian economy was very well developed. There was political unity among them, and it has very good trade relations relationship with other countries. And also, before the advent of East India Company in India, each village in India was a self-sufficient entity and was economically independent, as all the economic needs of the village fulfilled within the village only. India in pre-colonial phase has had a stable economy, flourishing trade and self-sufficient agriculture, and also it has rich handicrafts. Let us enter into the second phase, that is a colonial phase. From 1700 to 1947 is called colonial phase. East India established in India in the year of 1612, but the company rule started in the year of 1757. Let us come back from the screen that East India Company is started in our India in 1612, but the company rule started in the year of 1757, right? It was continued up to 1858, friends. Even though it is started in pre-colonial phase, it started its ruling in 1757 and it ruled up to 1858, friends. And during this age, our Indian share of economy in the world income is declared from 38% to 22.3%, friends. Why? Because there was two-way depletion of resources. That is, first one is, the Britishers would buy the raw materials from India at cheaper rates. And the second one is, they'll purchase the goods, finished goods in our Indian market at higher than the price which were present in our Indian market, right? These are the two reasons for the declination of the share of the India in world income. Let us enter into the third phase, post-colonial phase. The period is from 1947 till now is called post-colonial phase. History of Indian economy planned. That means the British government set up an officer in 1944. Bombay plan for 15 years. And People's Plan for 10 years, Gandhian Plan, there is no specific period for that, and Planning Commission, at the last, Planning Commission was set upon. Yeah, you know friends, our India got independence on 14th August 1947, right? But the Britishers declared our country as Purna Swaraj on 26th January 1930. From that day onwards, the literates of our country who were living in our country, they started thinking about our Indian economy. And the first thought was given by M. Visveshwaraya. You can see the picture of Vishwesharaya here on the screen, and the first thought of economic planning to India. First attempt to initiate economic planning to India was made by Mokshagundam Vishwesharaya, an engineer and politician, in 1934 through his book Planned Economy for India. Mokshagundam Vishwesharaya explained his views towards economy for India in 1934 through his book. Let us enter into the next slide. In 1944, Bombay Plan was presented by 8 leading industrialists of Bombay. In 1944, Gandhian Plan was given by Sriman Narayan Agarwal. You can see the picture of Sriman Narayan Agarwal in the slide. And let us enter into the next slide. That is, in 1945, People's Plan was given by Manabendranath Roy. You can see the picture of Manabendranath Roy on the screen. And the next slide, enter into the next slide. In 1950, Sarvodaya Plan was given by Jayaprakash Narayan. You can see the picture of Jayaprakash Narayan on the screen, please. Then, Planning Commission. The Planning Commission was set on March 15, 1950 under the chairmanship of Jawaharlal Nehru. You know that Jawaharlal Nehru was also known as Chacha Nehru, right? He was the first Prime Minister of our India. Planning Commission was worked for the 5 years plans, which are developed, executed and monitored by the Planning Commission. The 5 years plan was executed, developed and monitored by the Planning Commission only. Let us see what is meant by 5 year plan. The first Indian Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru presented the first 5 year plan to the Parliament of India on April 1st in 1951. It was mainly focused on the agriculture. Why? Because in India is agriculture based country, right? That is why agriculture got importance in first 5 year plan only. Because of some other reasons, agriculture got importance in first 5 year plan. Let us see why it is got importance. Yeah, it has share in national income, largest employment providing sector, contribution of equal capital formation, providing of food surplus to the expanding population, providing raw materials to industries, importance in international trade. Because of these reasons, based on these reasons, agriculture got importance and it is playing main role in our Indian economy. Let us see the list of 5 year plans which are happened in our India. Yeah, the first 5 year plan was from 1951 to 1955. Second 5 year plan from 1956 to 1960. Third 5 year plan from 1961 to 1965. Fourth 5 year plan 1969 to 1974, and the fifth 5 year plan for 1974 to 1979, sixth 5 year plan for 1980 to 1985, seventh 5 year plan for 1985 to 1990, eighth 5 year plan for 1992 to 1997, ninth 5 year plan for 1997 to 2002, tenth 5 year plan for 2002 to 2007, 11th 5 year plan for 2007 to 2012, 12th 5 year plan for 2012 to 2013. You may ask one thing, that why you kept that 5th 5 year plan in some other color. You may ask that doubt, right? Yeah, I'm here to explain your doubt that during the 5th 5 year plan there was an emergency. That emergency has a great impact on 5th 5 year plan. And also there was devaluation of the value of the rupee. That is why the 5th 5 year plan was not successfully completed. That is why the 5th 5 year plan was kept in red color. Then You may ask two more things. That why what is what happened the gap between third 5-year plan and fourth 5-year plan? There is 3 years gap, right? And also in same in the case of seventh 5-year plan, there was 2 years gap. You may ask that doubt, right? Yeah. During in 1966 there was green revolution and also there was devaluation of the value of the rupee. That is why the government declared the 3 years as plan holiday. From they prepared annual plans for each year. That is from 1966 to 1967 one annual plan, and 1967 to 1968 another annual plan, and from 1968 to 1969 another annual plan. Same in the case of 7th 5-year plan, but there was war and there was no political unity at the center. That is why they declared as planning holiday. There was 2 annual plans were formed during this 8th 5-year plan. Okay, let us enter into the next slide. That Niti Aayog, by the discontinuation of 12th 5-year plan, Niti Aayog came to existence. NITI stands for National Institute for Transforming India. It was started on January 1st, 2015. Instead of 5-year plan, it was established. Emblem is, you can see the emblem of the NITI Aayog on the screen. And also, you may ask one thing, that what is the difference between NITI Aayog and Planning Commission, right? The Planning Commission works for 5 years at one time only, but whereas in the case of Niti Aayog, it works for every year. That means it will make the plans for each and every year. They'll set goals for each and every year. They have to develop that, and they have to develop another sector. They'll set up goals like that. Then recently in 2016. In 2016, in 1991, the government introduced LPG, that is the economic reforms. They introduced LPG. L stands for liberalization and P stands for globalization. L stands for liberalization, P stands for privatization, and G stands for globalization. These are the economic reforms that changed India. Let us see what is meant by liberalization. The removal or loosing of restrictions on something, typically an economic or political system. Definition of the liberalization. Liberalization is a general term for any process whereby a state least restrictions on some private individual activities. Liberalization occurs when something which used to be banned is no longer banned, or when government regulations are relaxed. Here, by listening the word liberalization, you may got one doubt. What is the exact meaning of liber? Liber is nothing but giving freedom for the individuals. At the same time, the liberalization is the process giving freedom for individuals. Here it is, liberalization is the economic reform that is mainly based on economy and political. In the aspects of economy and political, we are giving freedom for the individuals. And what is meant by privatization? Privatization is the general process of involving that private sector in the ownership of operation of a state owned enterprises. Thus, the term refers to private purchase of all or part of a company. It covers contracting out and the privatization of management through management contracts, lease or franchise arrangements. By listening the word privatization, you got one word, that private. We are hearing that word from our childhood onwards, right? We are hearing that word from our childhood onwards. Private is nothing but that private sector is nothing but that that is under the control of one individual. That the government cannot control that that sector, but it has some restrictions. Here, privatization is nothing but the government companies. We have government companies, right? That government companies offered for the private sector that we are going to sell these companies, or we are going to give some share in that. The private sector members, that means the individuals, will come to approach this government, and they'll become the partners of that business. And let us see what are the causes of privatization. The major causes are to reduce the burden on government, to strengthen competition, to improve public finance, to fund infrastructure growth, accountability to shareholders, to reduce unnecessary interference, more disciplined labor laws. These are the major causes for happening of privatization, right? These are the major causes for happening of privatization. Let us see what is meant by globalization. Yeah. Let us see what is meant by globalization. The process by which business or other organizations develop international influence or start operating on an international scale. Definition. Globalization is not only with phenomenal spread and volume of cross-border economic transactions, but also with an organization of economic activities which straddle national boundaries. Yeah. By listening the word globalization, you got only one word, that is globe. Globe is a sphere which is having the world map around it, right? The globe is a sphere which is having the world map, right? Yeah. Here, the companies which are having a network in all countries of the world. Let us take the example of internet only. Internet, in each and every country we can find internet, right? That is the globalized, business. Let us see what is the demonetization. We are faced so many problems with demonetization, but there was some positive aspects and there was some, at the same time, we have negative aspects, right? What is meant by demonetization? Demonetization is the act of stripping currency unit of all unit of its status as legal tender. It occurs whenever there is a change of national currency. The current form of or forms of money is pulled from circulation and retired, often to be replaced with new notes or coins. Yeah, demonetization is nothing but, in simple terms, changing the currency and replacing the currency with new notes or coins. It was happened in our country for three times. Right? The first demonetization is happened in the year of 1946 on Jan 12th. It is for 1,000 and 10,000 notes were declared illegal tender. You can see the picture of 1,000 and 10,000 notes in the year of 1946. Later, these notes were republished by the Government of India in 1954 along with the 5,000 note. Let us see when the second demonetization happened. Yeah, the second demonetization happened on 16th January 1978 for 1,000 5,000 and 10,000 were declared illegal tender. The notes which were republished in 1954, they were again demonetized in 1978, friends. You can see the picture of 1,000 and 10,000 and also 5,000. Let us see. The third demonetization happened on 8th November 2016 for 500 and 1,000 notes were declared illegal tender. You can see the picture of 1,000 and 500 notes, and also the government of India introduced new notes. That is, for 500 they introduced new notes. Instead of 1,000 notes, they introduced 2,000 notes. You might have seen 2,000 notes and 500 notes. That is new version. This version is called Gandhi version. Gandhi version. Why they are called as Gandhi version? You may ask one thing, that is called as Gandhi version. Why? Because the picture of our father of nation, Gandhi, is present on the note. That is why it is called Gandhi version. Next, let us enter into next subtopic, that inflation, a general increase in prices and fall in purchase of value of money. The inflation rate is annual percentage change in the price levels. Inflation is nothing but a general increase in price. If the inflation will increase, the price will increase. If the inflation will decrease, then the price will decrease. That inflation is depends on our supply of money and also supply of goods and products, right? Let us see what are the causes for the inflation in India. The causes for inflation in India was, first one is increased public expenditure, difficulty in financing, unreliable agriculture growth, storage of necessary raw materials, and poor rise in industrial production. These are the causes of inflation in India. Let us see inflation data from 2000 to 2016. In 2016, inflation was below 4%, friends. Inflation was below 4%. Coming to 2009, the inflation was very high. It is beyond the stage of 12%, friends. In 2016, it was below 5%. But compared with 2000 to 2016, it was high. Somewhat high, right? Yeah. Let us see what is the inflation rate from March 2017 to 5th 2018. From April, they given that April, sorry, March, in March there was inflation below 4%, that is near to the 4%, but whereas in Feb, that is increased, that is 4.4%, right? The inflation is decreased from Jan 2018 to Feb 2018. That is a change which is happened because of the decrease in the price level, right? Nowadays, our inflation is coming down. Let us enter into the subtopic goods and service tax, which is known as GST. GST, goods and service tax, is an indirect tax which has replaced many taxes in India. GST was passed in the Parliament of India on 29th March 2017. Came into effect on 1st July 2017. At first, when they introduced GST, the prices of all goods, that means the prices of all electronic things and some clothes, were very high. Because of some revolutions, the managers, the sector heads, they done some revolutions for a small reduce in the prices of electronic things and clothes. Recently they introduced e-way bill. E-way bill is nothing but it will post on the goods and services which are transformed to interstates. That the value of the goods were more than 50,000. If the value of the goods were more than 50,000, they will collect the tax. That is e-way bill. Yeah, the GST came through the 121st Amendment to our Indian Constitution. Let us enter into our strengths of Indian economy. India is well placed to benefit from globalization and outsourcing. Demographics of India are favorable. There is much scope for increase in efficiency. Yeah, we have strengths of Indian economy, right? Where we have strengths, there was problems. There was problems, right? We have problems. We are facing some problems in our economy, that is inflation, poor infrastructure, poor education standard, balance of payment deterioration, high level of budget, large budget deficit, rigid labor laws. The problems of Indian economy were inflation, poor infrastructure, poor educational standard, balance of payment deterioration, high level of budget, large budget deficit, and the last one is rigid labor laws. And where we have strengths, at the same time we have problems, right? If we come across these problems, our Indian economy will develop. Let us see our final note. If these problems are solved, then the future of India looks bright. India might well become one of the superpower of the 21st century. India, a country with potentials for sustaining development. Our final note is stating that if we come across the problems which I mentioned in the last slide, that if we come across all those problems, our India will become the superpower of the 21st century. Then in 20th century, China is the superpower, right? If we cross all these problems, then our India becomes the superpower. In India is a country which is having sustaining development. And I'm concluding this topic with my words that so many people were talking about Indian economy, right? They were talking that our economy standards is coming down and GDP is falling. Let me give the real statistics and data which was given by our Global Investment Bank, that our GDP is falling, but at the same time inflation also falling. In 2014, before 2014, the inflation was from 8 to 12%, friends. The inflation was from 8 to 12% as an average. After 2014, there was inflation of below 5%. Then, if we take the consideration of inflation in our developing country, the inflation also takes into the consideration. Not only GDP takes into consideration, and inflation also takes into consideration. We have to know that, then we have to say our country is developing economy and our country has developing economy. Yeah. Some of them students send their doubts through email. Let us see what are they. What is mean by colonial phase? I already said that what is mean by colonial phase. The period from Indus Valley civilization to 1700 AD is called colonial phase. The meaning of the colonial is the control of other country people on one country. Like take the example of Britishers. Britishers ruled us for 200 years, right? They controlled us for 200 years. That is called colonial. The colonial phase is from Indus Valley civilization to 1700 AD. Let us see what is the next question. When Britishers declared our country as completely independent? Yeah, Britishers declared our country as completely independent in the year of 1930 on January 26th. Because of to remember that day, to remember January 26th, we made that our constitution came into force on 26 January 1950, right? On that day we are celebrating Republic Day. On January 26th in 1930, they declared our country as Purna Swaraj. Purna Swaraj is nothing but completely independent, friends. Purna Swaraj is nothing but completely independent. Let us see what is the third question. When e-way bill is going to commence? It is a brilliant question, friends, which I didn't cover in my topic. That is, e-way bill is going to commence on April 1st, 2018. It is going to truly affect from April 16th, 2018. It is going to deeply affect on April 18th, 2016. Okay, are you clear? Yes. What we discussed up to now? Up to now, we discussed about the three phases in our Indian economic history, and also we discussed about Planning Commission, and also we discussed about Niti Aayog, right? And also we discussed about demonetization, inflation, GST, and what are the strengths Indian economy having, and what are the problems Indian economy is facing. And some of the people discussing that our Indian economy is not at all developing. They don't know economics. That is why they are discussing like that. They don't know economics. That is why they are discussing about economy like that. They are discussing like GDP is just falling. The GDP is just falling. And they are not at all remembering that inflation also takes into consideration. If inflation is very low, the prices are very low. The prices being low, very low, is very very good for the common man, right? It is very good for the common man, and also it is very good for the middle class man. And our inflation also takes into consideration for the developing and developed countries. Inflation also takes into consideration, and as well as GDP also takes into consideration. But the people who are not known about economics, they are just seeing about the GDP only, but they are not at all seeing the inflation. Inflation also takes into consideration. Okay, and friends, I have one general question. That do you know who introduced our rupee symbol? Rupee symbol, you know that rupee symbol, right? The person who introduced rupee symbol, you know, do you know? Yes, Uday Kumar is the person who introduced rupee symbol. Each symbol has one meaning, right? The word rupee is derived from rupaya, the Sanskrit word rupaya, which is meant by a silver coin. The rupee symbol was given by Uday Kumar. He is an engineer, and he presented his symbol an rupee for the government, and among 3 lakhs of designs for the Indian rupee, he was selected. Why? Because it is taken from the English letters. We have 26 alphabets, right? From that, he chose R. R. He chose R. Then in Hindi letters, we have R, right? R. We have R like this, right? Through these two symbols, he makes these two letters, and he makes the symbol of rupee, Indian rupee. The word rupee is derived from the Sanskrit word rupaya, is nothing but silver coin. And I want to convey my sincere thanks to the person who is innovative and novel activities implemented in TTWRDC and as well as in TSWRDC is none other than our beloved secretary sir, RS Praveen Kumar sir. And also I want to convey my thanks to our principal sir, Dr. J. Virupakshapa sir. And also I want to convey my thanks to my mentor teacher Mumtaz ma'am. And also I want to convey my special thanks to my parents to give this birth and to join in this society. This is the first time to join in this society, friends. It was very good. This society is helping us to learn so much. And I also want to convey my thanks to my friends and my faculty of Ibrahim Patnam Degree College. And also I want to thank the spectators who are watching my class. And also I am thanking to the Mana TV team. I am thanking to you that, why? Because they were the mediators between you and me, right? I am thanking to you, sir, to the head of the Mana TV, and also to Sharma sir. A special thanks to Sharma sir. He is the coordinator of Mana TV, right? He is the coordinator of Mana TV. And I am very thankful to Spandana ma'am. Especially, I'm very thankful to Spandana madam. She corrected my PPT. She corrected my PPT and she helped me a lot to work for that. And we are gaining so much of knowledge through this program. This program is especially meant for learning is nothing but we have to earn while learning. While we are studying, we have to learn. Thanks. Thank you for giving this opportunity. Bye-bye.